By Saturday night, 8:30, we were fully full inside, and the queue for Rolling Stone show was right to the traffic light, past the light on the right. We come in here, my desk was there, that was our cloakroom, and two men outside the door. This bar wasn't there, it was just a dance hall. Stage was at the back where Alexis used to play. That stage wasn't that big, half a size. And another stage was here for Rolling Stone to play during the break. Yeah, it was the office before. We opened it up. It's that side. We opened it up and we made the stage. From there, we made it. From here, we made the stage to there for Rolling Stone. It was just two steps up. You go up. It was a nice stage. So when Alexis Corner went on tour, so they asked me, can we play on the main stage? So we tried them, and it went very well. Pete Townsend smashed two guitars in here, but they were phony guitars. They were not real ones. Here's the first one was real, second time he was told off. So it was a very cheap one he picked up and he smashed it. But because there were not much money at the time, they were just coming up. Those people were not famous at the time. When they played in here, they come up. This was a lady luck with that stage. Everyone played in that stage more or less become famous.
Scrappy place.
Sweaty.
Oh yeah, the moist hoist.
All condensation dripping from the wall. Like I'm living
just for your sweet kiss. It felt down. But the music was so great, you just didn't take any notice, you know. What you gonna say
now? And it quickly became a bit of a cult place to go, I think.
Well, what's interesting is, for me, the seriousness started right here in Ealing.
The other thing that blew my mind was Cyril Davies playing electric harmonica. And that was the first time that I realized that the sound of Chicago, the sound of Mississippi had actually arrived in London.
This was absolutely the place where we stood and talked. I know that it was in the back bit over there.
The Ealing Club really gave birth to the Rolling Stones.
It was the melting pot for all sorts of things that came later.
It was the foundation, really, of where all that British blues started.
The country had been very badly damaged. I mean, both physically and psychologically. Okay, we won the war, but it took a long time to win the peace.
I think sort of psychologically after the war, there was a huge desire to get back to some sort of normality, really. But there was quite strong pressures for conformity, really, that not to be different from other people, to dress the same, even to think the same, to behave the same.
And what our parents wanted, they wanted peace and stability and quiet. If you've been through the war, that's what you wanted. You wanted a bit of peace and quiet. You wanted a bit of normality. But for young people, it's like, what?
Well, you'd have to get dressed.
Spoil him all your life.
He's got his head stuck to the wall.
She's pointing to Anthony. For me, it was hearing jazz for the first time. And when I was about 11 or 12, 13 years old, that sort of age. And I was immediately interested in jazz. I bought my own record player. And I annoyed my parents with this, terrible noise.
This was the first generation of young people who had a music that was different from their parents. Yeah, their parents had been listening to, swing bands, to Glenn Miller and Frank Sinatra and Doris Day and Mantovani and Edmondo Ross and all this kind of stuff. And now you had rock and roll, you had skiffle, and then you had R&B and blues and jazz.
Nobody was dividing the music up into different things. It was just jazz music, and a lot of the blues guys just fell into the same story. And if you look at some of the music magazines at the time, you'll just find one after the other. Modern jazz, traditional jazz, then a blues pianist, and then a gospel singer. It was all music of that time.
Sister Rosetta Tharpe, I think. Chris Barber was the one who brought over American blues stars. He brought them over out of his own money and featured them during his set.
Chris, about 1957, started his big joint tours where he put them into his band so they could tour together. Chris was drawing people in so that they would see these artists that he thought people ought to see. It was adding them to an audience which already was interested in his music.
When I came along, I think the most important person of all who also doesn't get the credit was Chris Barber. He was the one who really set the ball rolling.
The first one we brought him was Big Bill Brunsey, and then the real tours we did, the proper things we did it really properly. Sister Rosetta Tharpe, which was October 57, Sonny J. Brown and McGee, which was in May 58, and then Muddy Waters, October 58.
Muddy appeared not in dungarees and looking like a cotton picker from the southern cotton fields of the States, but he appeared as a very sort of slick city guy with a solid electric guitar. So that was really quite an important milestone, I think, in the whole development of British blues, that 1958 tour of Muddy, because this was when the sort of electric guitar was seen more or less for the first time.
That man of fever! The little girl was jumping up in the floor, she patting her hands
again. I saw Muddy Waters when he came here in 58. I mean, I was actually shocked by the loudness of it, I was just shocked by this wild amplification. It was quite a big shock, and I think a big turning point in the way popular music went, really,
When Cyril and Alexis heard this, it completely changed their approach. Cyril in particular was very struck with Muddy Waters' band when it came, and his whole idea was that he wanted to recreate that sound in this country.
He was the most charming fellow you could ever meet.
What a gentleman.
Great enthuser.
Instantly recognisable.
He was very helpful to a lot of people, including me, as regards introducing me to the right people.
He was just a wonderful guy. He was so open.
I call him the father figure of the British blues movement.
There was no one before him.
control, power, touch, most of all resilience. We've known he's a champion.
In 1949, and I'd seen him playing at a club, and he was singing a blues, and I thought he was the most amazing person I had ever seen or heard. We had a home, so it was a place that musicians could come to, you know, and there was always a pot of tea. It got difficult sometimes, because after a gig they would come back to our house and they'd have in tow a whole lot of people who wanted to stay up all night. You go into your own kitchen and somebody says, "Oh, who are you?"
So in the course of the 50s, you got Bill Brunsey, Muddy Waters, Sonny Terry, Brownie McGee, Sister Rosetta Tharpe. They came and they played in Cyril and Alexis's club. Sister Rosetta Tharpe played a, you know, Gibson guitar, electric. Muddy Waters came with an electric band.
Cyril and Alex decided that it was a good idea to actually play some of this stuff using amplified guitars at least. We then started playing to the Roundhouse audience, and it was probably the loudest thing that the people in the street had heard since the last German bomb dropped in the war. So basically, I think Alexis was taken aside one evening and said, you know, don't bother to come back next week because we don't want you making that noise upstairs.
Apparently, Alexis Corner lost the club that they were playing in London. So they all got on a motorbike, Alexis Corner and Cyril Davis and Art Wood, and they drove around London on the motorbike looking for a new venue.
It was Art Wood, one of the older brothers of Ron Wood and the Rolling Stones. And he found this place in Ealing. So he came back one night and said to Cyril and Alexis, "Look, I think I've found somewhere where we can, you know, where we can play." So kind of Art had this motorcycle with like a pillion thing on the side. So Cyril was sitting in it. Alex kind of stood up all the way across London, and they went to see the guy who ran this place. Got a whole lot of tricks I'm keeping here on
ice. I got my mold working. And Alexis Corner came in, the friend came in and said, "I've got a friend want to practice in the afternoon." So they came and practiced, and we said the right to the place for nearly 8 months, 7 to 8 months on Saturday night.
And they came to an agreement about they would take I can't remember exactly how it went, but there was the door money, the money that you take on the door from the people, and the money that you take over the bar. So I think maybe Alexis arranged that they would take money of people coming in, and the guy would keep the profits from the booze that they sold over the bar. So they started this on the 17th of March 1963. 17th of March 1962, and it was the first venue for electric blues in this country. I got my brand on you.
I went to the opening night, and it was pouring with rain, but it was wonderful, yes. I mean, we knew that it was going to be a very special club.
You know, this was the first night. It was advertised as being the new R&B club. The personnel as it started up at the Ealing Club, there was Alexis, Cyril Davis, myself, Andy Hookaboo. The drummer was Charlie Watts.
Went on that night to see them, and it was a revelation. It was just what I wanted.
Well, it's the first time I ever heard a harmonica played like that.
The other thing that blew my mind was Cyril Davies playing electric harmonica, and that was the first time that I realized that the sound of Chicago, the sound of Mississippi had actually arrived in London.
Certainly the first known rhythm and blues band in the UK. I certainly can't think of anybody else that was doing that kind of music before they did it.
And Alexis wasn't a conventional band leader. He was a kind of musician's impresario who hired people for specific jobs. So the personnel of Blues Incorporated was fairly stable for a short period at the beginning, but changed quite frequently as the time went on.
What Alexis was very good at was encouraging young musicians to come up and play a song or two with the band.
We used to gather along the front of the stage at the Ealing Club. Andy Wren, me, Mick Jagger, and Alexis would just, you know, go, "You, what do you want to sing?" And, you know, it would be sort of, "Kansas City, okay, off you go."
If Alexis was on stage, he would just say, "You want a jam? Come on, get up. Hey, why didn't you get Mick up as well?" You know, and the two of us would put our heads together. "What are we going to do? What are we going to, you know, we have to find some common ground somewhere. Okay, yeah, I'm sure you know Billy Boy Arnold's song, I Ain't Got You. Yeah, let's do that."
And a lot of guests coming in, like American singers from who were actually Air Force personnel, they would come down and sing. Ronnie Jones was one.
I remember when we did play, I think, if I remember correctly, the Ealing Club, Alexis had Mick on stage. When he came on, he asked Alexis, and Alexis said, "Ask Ronnie." He knew all of the old blues tracks.
And it quickly became a bit of a cult place to go, I think, as far as fans were concerned. And we used to get in a lot of people sort of dropping in and just sitting in.
Middle of 62, the band had, you know, established itself in Ealing and in London, central London, the Marquee and other places as well. But there was the beginnings of problems between Cyril and Alexis. Alexis was probably more jazz-oriented and jazz-influenced than Cyril really was prepared to put up with. Alexis wanted to bring in Graham Bond. And Graham was also a very big guy and a large personality. And he arrived on the scene and Alexis got him in the band and he had this massive Hammond organ with him and plonked it on the stage and kind of just took over, really. And Cyril really had had enough. You know, it was like this was a push too far, Graham.
In the All-Stars, when Cyril went off on his own, the All-Stars, he created a really exciting band, a band that really rocked. And get people dancing on the floor. Everyone would be on the floor. There'd be no one standing around.
The amazing thing about Cyril was when Muddy Waters heard him playing, he asked him to join his band. I mean, that, you know, that is astounding for a white guy to join Muddy Waters' band playing harp. He was the best I ever heard.
Cyril, he was a difficult guy to deal with, quite kind of grumpy and moody, but at the same time probably one of the best blues musicians that this country has ever produced.
His charisma, it was heads down and just went for it, you know. No technique in the sense of finesse, but just really, really, just completely authentic.
No, he wasn't copying anybody, he was Cyril. It's a big shame that he died, you know.
Alexis Corner and Cyril Davies as a partnership was an exciting partnership because they were different people. They were very different in character.
I put a tiger in the tank. I put a tiger in the tank.
I remember playing somewhere like in Wales with Alexis and being attacked by the audience because they had never heard anything music like this. And Cyril's got a mic stand, he's swinging. Laying people out with his mic stand.
He was always said to be a rough and ready man. He was had a physical job, repairing cars and panel beating.
He had the same temperament as Ginger Baker.
Cyril was a fantastic fella. He was just straight to the point, no messing around,
But Alexis seemed to be the catalyst. He brought people together.
It was always Alexis that would be a magnet for me to go down to London and sit with him and talk about nothing else but music and peace.
I never knew him be impatient or say, look, I'm really sorry, I can't speak now. You know, he always had time for you.
Start kicking it off and getting kids interested and familiar with that music.
He influenced a whole generation because all the people from the club would spread out and get their own bands. I put
a tiger in. That whole scene really owes a lot to him.
Just of having had the opportunity to walk in his shadow, for me today when I think about it, it's a huge honor.
Cyril and Alexis were the first people really to get close to the kind of heaviness of the Chicago music. Cyril in particular was quite a rough guy. He was a panel beater. He scared a lot of people, but he had that kind of intensity that was needed. But Alexis really had the personality. He knew people. He knew people at the BBC. But he was really like a father figure for many musicians.
I really do not know why West London took up rhythm and blues in the way in which it did. But there's absolutely no doubt that it was West London that took up the rhythm and blues thing.
Yeah, down a few steps.
The Ealing Club, which was the first club that called itself a rhythm and blues club, was open because we could no longer go on playing at the pub we were playing at because we were playing electric music and it was too loud for the customers.
It's just down in here on the left.
We decided that this was absolutely ridiculous that America was forgetting about blues.
That's where we all used to blow down there, Mick. Eric Burdon, everyone used to show up.
And we decided that really it was time that blues became popular music again. What a terrible thing to say. We decided.
There's the railway.
But we were obsessive like that.
Yeah, I suppose.
Pure fanaticism puts out a buzz.
Well, know what they'll put
we in scouted there. Around West London and we found this drinking club by Ealing Broadway Station.
Back door used to be all the way around here.
It was a small club, held about 200 people. We opened it on St. Patrick's Night, 1962. From the first night, it was absolutely packed.
Yeah, there it is.
I don't think we were at all aware of a social revolution.
There doesn't seem to be any way in. Seems to be it for today, whatever happens. Well, a lot of people played here, certainly. It was a start.
Was really a scruffy place.
Hole in the ground.
It reminded me of the speakeasies in the old American gangster films.
Of course, when you went down these dark steps and in the door, and it kind of had a sense of decadence about it, you know, you really thought, this is the business, this is the place.
It was a difficult gig to get into. You had to carry your guitar and amp down these very narrow stairs. It was usually raining. Or I remember it was usually raining. And you'd slip and you'd slide and you'd fall over, but you protect your guitar.
Sweaty.
Condensation dripping from the wall.
And I remember someone saying to me, that's not condensation, that's rain coming in from the street above.
The
there was always a big puddle. If it was raining, there was a gigantic puddle on the right-hand side of, at the end where the stage was, on the right-hand side.
Everyone said later on, oh yeah, the moist hoist. I do remember that people said, oh, Charlie Watts couldn't play his drums because the condensation, it was just constantly dripping. And of course, once those heads got that wet, you know, it would, instead of going crack, it would go.
But to me, the most exciting thing was standing there with my guitar, watching the water running down the wall, wondering if I'd be killed when I touched the microphone.
Somebody got electrocuted, I can't remember who it was now.
I would say health and safety today would have had a field day. It would have never have got off the ground and would never have been allowed to be there.
It felt down. But the music was so great, we just didn't take any notice, you know.
Every time it rained, you used to get soaking wet, the place leaked, and it was just horrendous. But it was a great club. It was a good vibe, and it was just a rocking place.
It was just a great atmosphere for some reason. Everything that went on there was cool, you know. And Ferry, bless him, the guy that ran it was this weird, amazing kind of, I don't know if he was Egyptian or Turkish or something. I don't know.
Iranian.
Iranian?
Yeah.
Oh, was he? And quite strict, but very, his kind of moods, he was very moody. Sometimes he would give you a big hug and give you a free beer. And other times you'd have to get on and fuck off, you know. He was great.
This is when we arrived in Ealing College, Ealing Technical, which is a London University now, West London University. It's shaking, isn't it?
I arrived here in 1959.
I was head of Students' Union at the time. Ealing was okay, very nice, very quiet. Nothing was open after 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock. And we used to rent Ealing Town Hall. We were told off in council, you can't have the town hall to rent every week. And the crossroad is the pub, which is the dance hall. So we hired the two twice, and the ceiling shook. They said no more. So we were looking for a place, and we found a place down the stairs, Ealing, called Ealing Club. And we tried to get there for one night a week, and landlord made us 6 weeks to go, come back, go, come back. The morning he was there, he used to say, go, come back next week. I could understand why. And next week we went there, I went there myself. He said, hello, how are you? What you doing? What you wanted again? I said, for the college, we want to hire one night a week for the art school. We got a group to play. Or I'd come back next week. So he wanted to try us, very, very shrewd Englishman. So it took 6 weeks before he said, okay. I didn't give in. And he was keep trying to see how serious I was. And then he decided to let me have it for one night, then one night developed to 7 night.
England's, or I should have said London's, cavern.
Yeah, it's actually got a better range of musicians than if you compare it with the cavern.
The very first time I went, it was the music that had the impact rather than, should we say, the actual club itself. But the music was very different. I came down here and heard this music for the first time, really. Amplified electric blues.
And everybody would know they were listening to something special. And they knew it. They knew they were in. It was as if they knew they were making history. That was really exciting. Yeah. And it didn't happen in many places.
we felt that this was a kind of a music that we'd almost discovered, and that was almost like some sort of secret society almost.
Because they'd leave and they'd talk to their friends at school or at college, and they knew that their friends wouldn't know what they were talking about.
When I started trying to get into playing R&B myself in 1962, and I met Paul Jones, and Paul had already met Brian Jones, and I didn't meet Brian at that point, but we felt like we were part of some obscure cult or sect. And someone told me about a guy in Tooting who had, I think it was a Muddy Waters album, might have been a Sonny Boy Williams, I can't remember. He had an album. It's 1962. And I got his address from a friend of a friend of a friend. And I went over there one night and knocked on the door, 7:30. His mother came to the door and said, "I've heard there's someone in this house has got a John Lee Hooker album." And she looked at me and she sort of called back, "Derek," you know. And this young guy, my age, came along the corridor and I said, "Have you got a John Lee Hooker album?" And he said, "Yeah." He showed it to me at the front door, you know. And I just held it and looked at it, you know. I said, "Thank you." And went away, you know. It was that important to me to sort of connect with the music, just hold the artifact in my hand, you know.
The word began to spread amongst all these different people, who none of them kind of knew each other, that there was this club, this place on a Saturday night in West London where you could hear the blues. So they all began to come down to the club. At that time, there were little pockets of blues fans around the country, and people who were budding musicians and who were actual musicians. So you had Eric Burdon of the Animals up in Newcastle. You had Brian Jones playing out in West of England in Cheltenham. You had people like Paul Jones, or you called Paul Pond in those days. You had Keith Richard and Mick Jagger. You had various musicians who were all still in their teens.
Considering that Alexis Corner and Cyril were a little bit older than most of the bands around, the audience was a very young audience, young girls, boys, 15, 16, 17, and they used to pack, they used to queue to get in, the place would be packed.
There were ages between 16, 17 to about 19, 20, 21, 22, no more.
So yeah, London becomes a kind of a place very closely associated with young people.
You had the result of the baby boom after the Second World War, and so young people were a very powerful presence on the streets, but commercially, for the first time, they had some money. Hey, fellas, have you
heard the news? There was more disposable income, and there was the beginning of things called youth culture, the beginnings of the things called teenagers. There was a huge new market of young people who had more money now than their parents had ever seen. And the things that young people wanted to spend it on were clothes, were records.
There was full employment in the country. So if you'd been to, if you left school, there was a job to go to. If you left university or art school, there was a job to go to. It might not be the ideal job, but there was a job. And if you left your job on a Friday, you could get another job on the Monday morning.
I think it was a time of great change. And for me, my parents were quite old-fashioned, and you was very much torn between, you know, their old-fashioned views on life and how I really wanted to sort of get out and create and be part of the whole 60s scene.
The war meant nothing to us because we were born after the war.
So, and it was, you know, obviously now we realise it was just an awful time. You can't even dream about it. You know, you can't even think what some of those people went through. You know, we just used to say, why do you keep banging on about the war, for Christ's sake? You know, why can't we go and have a good time?
So there was a lot more free thinking, a lot more sense of things that were possible, that you didn't have to do exactly what your parents did. You know, you didn't have to have, you know, 2.4 children and a telly and a car and all of that. You know, there were other possibilities.
We had to break the mould. The mould had to be broken. There were certain of us. It was, some of it was even was political as well. You know, the conventional life went along with a political attitude that we didn't like as well. You know, it wasn't progressive. It wasn't. It didn't work socially. It didn't work sexually. It didn't work in all sorts of ways, and that had to be broken. It had to be changed.
It was an era when a lot of social reform happened in the UK. So the censorship laws in theatre and literature were gotten rid of. You know, you had the pill, you had a lot more sort of sexual freedom.
You could be doing the worst band in the world, and the women would like throw themselves at you. I'm serious, they would. People don't believe it, it's absolutely true. They would be waiting outside the back door. It would be absolutely, you'd be knee deep in women, seriously. And because, as you say, it was just a new revolution for them, as the same as it was for blokes. And no bloke is going to say no.
You get invited to all the best parties. You know what I mean? You meet some gorgeous ladies. You know what I mean? You can get picky and choosy. You know, go away, you're too fat. You know what I mean? I don't like you the way you stared at me. Leave. You know what I mean, man?
Is there were social changes in Britain at that time. You'd come out of the Second World War, come out of having food rationing. The economy was sort of on the up. And it also abolished what was called national service.
I think I'm right to say the last call-up papers were issued at the end of 1960. There wasn't that kind of same space for personal, artistic or cultural development that opened up as a result of national service ending.
Everything that I ever did happened because I didn't do military service. Had I done military service, none of those things could have happened.
You know, when you compare the 60s to the 1950s, especially the early 1950s, then the 60s seems to be a very different kind of England, a very different kind of London.
The mid-60s was really, it was like we just got hold of the reins, really, young people, do you know what I mean? Beforehand, you know, it was the war and all that, and you were being told what to do and pretty much had to go along with it.
There was a welfare system that looked after. You could try what you wanted to do. You know, if you wanted to be an actor, you wanted to be a sculptor, you wanted to be a musician, you wanted to be a dancer, whatever, you could take a little time out and try it.
But it was a time when people were prepared to take a risk and not get stuck in that horrible conventional thing of having a job for the rest of your life, doing something that you hated, working for someone that treated you like shit.
What musicians and that did in those days was took a big gamble, really big gamble, you know, because it could have all gone wrong.
Yeah, it's like a revolution. No one had ever done it before. It was all new. Everybody could dream. Be what you want to be. Go for it, man. Dream. Go for it. It is all possible. The world is changing.
The excitement generated by a night in the Ealing Club, the power and the intensity of that music was somehow symbolic of a kind of a progression, a moving forward for young people. post-war generation coming out of austerity, all the new social freedoms and opportunities that now existed, disposable income, all the things that this group of young people, their parents had never enjoyed. In a sense, that explosion that you got from that club somehow, I think, kind of symbolised all what had been happening, the progresses that had been made economically and socially since the end of the war.
This first number we're going to do is a John Lee Hooker original. It's called Boom Boom, this one. A boom, 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 boom. Shoot your rat down. Right off of your feet. Take you home with me.
Mick Jagger was there and Keith Richards was there. And I met people from Birmingham, Spencer Davis, from Newcastle, guys who were in a band called The Animals. Have you heard of them? No, I haven't heard of them, you know, but you will.
You knock me out right off of my feet.
I just remember my memory of standing across the street, so I was still feeling like I was an outsider. Yeah. But then I heard Cyril Davis, and it just threw me across the street into the club, and I felt at home.
Come on and shake, shake the baby. Come on and shake, shake the baby.
I gravitated to it because they knew that that was a genre of music that mainly came out of there.
I understand Harold Pendleton, who was, I think at the time, running the National Jazz Federation, and came down to see how it was going. I thought, because he'd got the Marquee Club, and that was sort of floundering a bit. This is the original Marquee Club in Oxford Street. And thought, well, I could do with some of that at my club. And so then opened up the Marquee Club to blues evenings. And from there, I mean, that's really where... So the Ealing Club was the progenitor, I think, of all of those sort of clubs that then later on happened. And then, so once you got the Marquee Club, which being in central London, was able to attract people from all over London.
I do think that the Ealing Blues Club was very important, and had it not been for the fact that they, you know, Chris had been this driving force and was involved with Harold Pendleton at the NJF, that, you know, Harold might not have decided to put on rhythm and blues nights at the Marquee, and of course everybody followed suit.
From the beginning of 63 to the end of 63, everything changed completely. We were like a minority, trying to find an audience, trying to find other musicians. By the end of 63, it was the music in London.
One more time.
Everybody wanted to be part of a blues or a rhythm and blues band.
A lot of jazz clubs were making the move. Like the Marquee began as a jazz club, and suddenly, you know, bands like Manfred Mann, the Stones were appearing there.
If you walked along Oxford Street, across Tottenham Court Road, and into Kilburn, into Holborn and that sort of area, and there would be a pub, you come to a pub, there would almost certainly be a blackboard outside saying, blues band tonight. I can remember we used to go to two or three clubs in the same evening. We'd start in one club that we'd never been to before and had a few drinks and listened to a band, and then we'd stay and listen for half an hour, and then we'd leave and we'd walk, or if we were late, run or catch a bus to the next one, and we'd do three or four in a night.
Maybe one more time.
That's how word got around, you know. You'd meet up with people and you say, I saw you the other night in so-and-so pub. Oh, yeah. By the way, have you heard this new band? There's another band that's over playing at blah, 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 you know. You had to really, you know, you just had to go around and check out. And there were some really good bands around that never actually really ever got recorded. And, you know, I mean, it was a very exciting time.
That was the blues, and the blues was a kind of symbol of an independence. I don't listen to chart music. I listen to, you know, bands. Because those very bands who were underground went on, some of them, to have big hits. Yeah.
And one of the good things about it was that a lot of them were very, very particular about saying who'd written particular songs. I mean, Mick
Jagger was quite good at that. Paul Jones always used to say, written by Sam Sam, give the people credit. I mean, most of those guys who'd written those songs weren't actually performing at that time in America. They're totally unrecognised by the American public.
By accident, we invented British rhythm and blues. So when the Stones and people went to America, the Americans thought it was British music. But it wasn't. It was American music that we couldn't play. Thrill is gone. Thrill is gone away. The thrill is gone, baby.
When we went to America, we had a massive hit with Doo Wah Diddy Diddy in America. And we went over there, and you're talking to journalists, and they say, where'd you get this music? And we'd say, well, we got it from you. We got it from Muddy Waters. We got it from Howling Wolf. Howling?
We weren't even so much pointing to ourselves, you know, look at how great we are. We were always pointing to those guys across the water. And saying, you should listen to these, you know, and, you know, every one of us pretty much did that.
Every time someone interviewed the Rolling Stones, they would mention Little Walter, Howling Wolf, Muddy Waters, all those guys. They would say, this is where we get this music from. And people would go, Howling Wolf? What the hell's that, you know?
What we did, in some way, I was going to say small way, but I think in quite a big way, gave a lift to the careers of people that we loved so much, the Sonny Boy Williamses, the Muddy Waters, the Howling Wolves, B.B. King, all those people, you know. I'm not saying they wouldn't have had more years of success without us, but it is possible, and we certainly credited them at every opportunity. And just to be on the TV and think, there's John Lee Hooker. He's on English television, prime time. You know, fantastic.
This is very familiar.
We heard that Alexis had started up the rhythm and blues nights here at the Ealing Club, and so we came, Mick, Keith and myself, and we saw Alexis, which was brilliant, and we thought, this is the real thing, for about 3 weeks. And then I remember us distinctly saying, hey, we could do this. We had made a recording to play to Alexis, and we thought we got to find a name, and I think it was Mick who came up with the name of Little Boy Blue and the Blue Boys. We used to rehearse very largely around my parents' house, and my mother would supply us with cups of tea and Jaffa cakes. After a couple of weeks, I think we saw Brian Jones down here. We definitely played along with Paul Jones.
So Brian would often come from Cheltenham. With Cheltenham to Ealing, you pass Oxford, and that was where I was still living. And then on the Saturday, we would, you know, go to the Ealing Club. I mean, really, every Saturday. That would be early 62. A matter of weeks later, Brian rang me, and he said, I'm forming a band. He said, you and I have been not taking this thing seriously. He said, what's the word, dilettantes? I said, I'm serious. He said, I know, but so am I. And he said, I'm going to London, I'm gonna get a flat, I'm starting a band, and I'm gonna become very rich and very famous. Do you want to be my singer? And I said, no. I said, no. And the rest is somebody else's history, not mine.
Second British vocal group, second world vocal group, top British rhythm and blues group, and best new group, the Rolling Stones.
See, the joy boys are rocking, going round and round, yeah, reeling and rocking, while they create the sound. But they never stop rocking till the moon went down.
We were very impressed with Brian. We started talking to him, and he said, Mick, why don't you come and sing with my band? Which he did, took along Keith, and then Brian said, well, do I come and play bass? Have you ever played the bass? I said, no, but it's got less strings than a guitar, so it can't be that hard.
When we get to the Ealing Club, Alexis came up to the rhythm section, Jack, me and Johnny Parker, and said, would we forego the interval and do it with Mick Jagger and Brian Jones? And we used to play games on Jagger, like playing intricate time things and throwing him off, you know. And Brian was always going, no, Mick, one thing for you, putting it back on the beat.
And we're 12 o'clock, and you're the first suspect.
This thing about where and when did the Rolling Stones start is a very difficult question, because it kind of was an amalgam, really, of Brian's band and Little Boy Blue or whatever. This was absolutely the place where we stood and talked. I know that it was in the back bit over there.
Certainly Brian met Mick and Keith at the Ealing Club. Everybody met everybody in that place.
We used to do quite a bit of, well, we do Rolling Stone Blues, I Ain't Got You, which was a number we certainly would have done, several Chuck Berry songs, Round and Round. We do slide numbers with Brian. We do numbers where Keith would do Chuck Berry stuff. I know one we probably didn't do, which Mick and Keith and I wishes to do, was La Bamba, because he used to sing La Bamba, making up this sort of nonsense Spanish thing, and it would go on for absolutely ages. But we definitely wouldn't have done that down a blues club, because we'd have probably been thrown out.
I was there with Jack, and we weren't terribly impressed with the music, but it was so... sort of raw, and there was just something about it that was obviously very commercial, you know. These guys trying to play stuff that they couldn't really play, but what came out was sort of, there was something there, you know. So the Ealing Club really gave birth to the Rolling Stones.
I told you once and I told you twice.
From what I can remember, obviously, Mick here, for sure. I have a feeling that the piano was over this side, with, of course, Ian Stewart rattling away. Drummer, there. Whoever he was, because the drummers in the early Rolling Stones used to change like people change his shirt. I was somewhere like this. I mean, the stage is actually really deep, but I kind of would have been at the back alongside the drummer and Keith, and again, Keith, which side? I think this side, Brian that side, I believe.
I remember Rolling Stone played, you won't believe, we paid 7 and 6. You get 75p, we paid, because nobody came. It's only 5 people because it was snow. It wasn't weekend, it was weekdays, and nobody came out.
The reason I kind of left was the fact I was slightly, I just frustrated with, I wanted to play guitar. And Phil May, who I was at art school with, and also had come here a few times, and he said, why don't we start a band? And that's how the Pretty Thing started.
They picked up very quick. It's done within 7 or 8 months of playing down the club. He couldn't control the crowd. We have thousands of people following Rolling Stone.
lineup changed a few times, but essentially the Stones as we know it had gathered and they first met each other at Ealing.
The old name of the borough in London was, it was the queen of the suburbs.
And what was more working class area, Ealing, parts of Ealing were and still are sort of much more upmarket. But there was a lot of venues around for musicians to play at that time.
The scene was so heavy in Hamwell, South or Ealing. You know, this whole area was so vibrant.
That's the amazing thing, that something was happening in Ealing.
It was great, because there were loads of West Indians and lots of Irish people, and it had a good international feel, even in the late 50s and early 60s. And that was inspirational for the music.
I would say that in my experience, that was why the Marshall opened their shop in Hamlet, because they lived locally. Probably the premises became vacant. It was a good location near the tube station and the main Uxbridge Road going through, and it was obviously a perfect spot for a music shop.
Father was being pushed to open up a drum shop. From pressure from my dad's pupils, who were playing guitarists, they chased and said, well, why didn't you open it as a proper music shop? And then eventually becoming a general music shop. We opened that in the summer of 1960. The first amplifier was sold in 93 Uxbridge Road.
Jim Marshall's shop was an institution with young musicians. We used to go in there and sort of talk rubbish and, you know, try out the guitars. And at that stage, Marshall's wasn't a legend. It was just a music shop.
And everybody would meet in Jim Marshall's music shop. Some people would be buying guitars and amplifiers, other people would just go in there, strings. Any reason to be in there, because you'd meet all the different people that were playing at the Ealing Club and involved in this new kind of music. And it was wonderful.
I remember I used to always run into Ronnie Wood there, who seemed to live there.
Crowd round, everybody's trying to get into the shop to listen to it, and it was great. They'd all be in there, Keith Moon, Johnny Entwistle, Townsend, all these faces.
Mitch Mitchell kind of looked after the drum side of everything, so people who wanted bits mended or bits got.
Mitch obviously lived near enough within walking distance of the shop. He lived with his parents in Masonette, above a set of retail shops. And he used to be in the shop regular, and we started him off as a Saturday boy.
I was playing with a band called the Artwood Combo prior to that, a blues band. I'd only been with them for a few months. They later became the Artwoods, which the people would know about. And we got this gig one Sunday night at the Ealing Club. I got there early and waited, and these guys never showed up.
So of course the place was packed with all his friends, and he got there and the Artwood Combo never turned up. They never turned up.
And Ferry was saying, well, I've got no band tonight, what am I going to do? Mitch Mitchell happened to be there, who I'd already known as a friend in Hamel. Said, well, look, I can go and get my drums, I only live in Hamel.
So Terry Marshall said, well, I could go home and get my saxophone. Roddy Freeman said, well, I could go and get my guitar and I'll sing.
And we formed the band for the night.
They did the whole night, just a jam, called themselves the Soul Messengers, and apparently Ferry was so pleased he gave them a Sunday night residency for a year.
For Mitch Mitchell, I don't know quite what he was doing before that, but probably his first chance to play with a really professional band. It was good exposure to a lot of people and the chance to really, you know, develop his skill on the drums and playing with, you know, experienced guys. And then he went for George. So I think it was a very good period for him to, you know, expand his talent and just generally get exposure, you know, which we did in the Ealing Club.
It was an important
venue for all of these guys, because this is kind of where you cut your teeth, you know, as a kind of young player playing locally with a whole range of different musicians and different styles. It's kind of where you learn your chops. And of course, he was working in a music shop as well, which was, you know, in the local area.
Oh, I love Mitch Mitchell. I love him to pieces, you know, I always have done. He's really my favourite drummer.
But nobody could lay it down like Mitchell. I mean, he was only a little guy, but when he hit the kit, you know, he used to explode. Yeah, he was wonderful.
I said to him one day, he was with Georgie Fame, I don't know if you know that, but I said, I'm really sorry, I'd heard he'd lost the gig with Georgie Fame. And he said, yeah, it's a bit of a drag. And I said, have you got anything lined up? He said, not really. He said, I did an audition for this black guy, but I don't think it'll come to anything. So I'll leave you to fill in the gaps.
Bands that were motivated at the time. We went along the same line with Marshall. It was a roller coaster. As per the growth of The Who, Hendrix, same thing happened with Cream he sent in.
And of course, when Cream came along, we used a lot of Marshalls, killed a lot of Marshalls. Did my audition to join Blues Incorporated at the Ealing Club, coincidentally. The other guy who was up for the audition was playing bass guitar, but I was playing double bass, acoustic, not amplified, and I was louder than the guy playing the bass guitar. So I got the gig. And that really changed my whole life, my whole career. Stemmed from that moment. That was my first big time band, if you like, because it was a big time band, although the Ealing Club is very small and everything.
We were all playing with the Johnny Birch Octet, and Axel Smith joined Alexis. And then Jack joined Alexis. And then they came up with the fact that they weren't terribly happy with Charlie. And Charlie, bless his heart, he left the band so that I could join him. He even helped me set my kit up for the first rehearsal.
With Alexis, I could just be myself. I had this double bass wedged in my groin and I was playing low E notes that were vibrating through my sexual areas, and it was just a fantastic time to be alive. The band got very, very good, very tight, very sleazy, wonderful music.
We had a regular gig at the Ealing Club. It was a dark rectangle, I think, just like a long rectangle with a stage at one end. It was always packed solid with people. Alexis Corner. Graham joined Alexis Corner after Cyril. He was a crazy guy, was Graham.
By early 1963, Graham Bond, whose idea really was he wanted his own band. He wanted his own band. Neighbor, neighbor. He got a chance of a gig up in Manchester at the Twisted Wheel, I think. And he took Jack and Ginger with him. And they got paid £70. They thought they'd won the lottery.
We're driving back down the motorway and Graham's going, "Oh man, that's it, we've won the pools. This is it, we've made it. This is real big time. We've got to do now, go out on our own, you see." And I said, "Graham, wait a minute. We just did one gig. We're doing good with Alexis. Like, let's take it easy." Well, the next day we had a gig in the Marquee. And I turned up and I just picked up my script and went straight in the cars and had a fix. And I came out to be confronted by Graham saying, "We've left the band."
We've left the band. You know, there's no kind of discussion about it. It's like, right, we've left the band.
I said, "What do you mean we left the band?" He said, "I just told Alex we've left the band. You left the band for me and Jack." And it was a done deal. We'd left the band. And then the Graham Bond organisation started.
One day I came into the Marquee for a rehearsal, I think it was, at the Marquee. And Alexis was really strange to me. He kind of looked at me really strangely, and we were always very, you know, he's always very nice to me. And I said, "What's wrong?" He said, "Well, you didn't tell me you were leaving the band," which I didn't know about. But I just went along with it. That's the way I was in those days.
There was no British band that had sounded anything like that ever.
Graham had the sound. Oh, neighbor, neighbor.
Alexis certainly introduced them to aspects of the blues that perhaps they were not entirely conscious of. And then they sort of took off from there, you know, and found their own thing, first with Graham and then with Cree. Open your
As I said, 20% or 25%, we had the mobs. Mobs used to come in.
The mods who came out of West London, they came out of where sort of the Ealing Club was founded. They were very fashion conscious. You know, they wanted the latest Italian style suits, and Italian fashion was big news in the West End in the early 60s.
I was a mod. I had a scooter, a Lambretta LI150 for my sins, yeah. Smothered in headlights, racks back and front, you know, that sort of thing. We played here in 64. Great little venue, like The Who played down there, in Action, all the top names of the time, you know, great stuff, really great stuff. Are you gonna
say those magic? They were just an excellent band. They were on a par with The Who and The Small Faces.
And these were bands that we were travelling around after. So one week it would be The Who and the Small Faces, and you'd see The Tribe coming the week after. So we were all following each other.
And then the bands that came out of that, like most famously The Who, you know, were like the kind of the, they were the poets of mod.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's my privilege, and I really do mean that, to introduce and welcome, I think, one of the truly great men of contemporary music. I choose those words very carefully. Note, I didn't say rock and roll, I said contemporary music. I think he's that important. Ladies and gentlemen, Pete Townsend.
Well, what's interesting is, for me, the seriousness started right here in Ealing. And Alexis Corner started their concerts there in 62, possibly, 62. Because I remember getting this record, which was on the jukebox at Sid's Caff opposite the what is now the University of West London, which was then Ealing College Art School, was the bit that I was at. The art school was a part of the facility there, as it is now. They put that Country Line special with the Cyril Davis group on that jukebox, and so you would sit there with your dripping toast and your cup of steaming tea and listen to this unbelievable record, you know, which was recorded by a guy down the road in Ealing, you know. And of course Alexis Corner was the man that we call in our business, it's so sad that he's not with us anymore, the father of English blues. Without him, I don't think Mick and Keith would have collated the record collection they had. Keith Richards unfortunately moved to America many years ago, but I see Mick all the time, and we'll occasionally talk about the Ealing Club, and we'll talk about Ealing, and we'll talk about the early days, the 100 Club up in London, and some of the other places we played, you know, one near where I now live in Richmond, and the birth of the club scene and the blues scene in London, and so much of that early work. You know, the Stones, I think I read in Bill Wyman's book, did 400 shows in 1963. 400. So on some days, they're doing two or three shows a day. You know, so to break was, you know, appears to be very easy because there weren't that many bands around in those days. And most of the bands that were around, I think, were pretty good.
The boys were from Ealing and they decided to come one night to listen to Manfred Mann. Then they introduced themselves and we become friends. And they said, "You've got a manager now called Keith Lambert." We used to drink a lot. And I said, "Why don't you play one night?" He said, "All right, call a kid in and we discuss it." So we had The Who. Yeah, they played, The Who played for us, as I recall, on and off for 6 months.
Around 1965, the musicians who had been heavily involved in the British, what we call the British rhythm and blues scene, discovered, or dare we say it, the emerging psychedelic hippie culture. And certainly, classic case in point would be a band like The Who, who were sharp-dressed mod band, but then, subsequently, within the space of a very short time, had become a hippie band with long hair, doing rock operas, and doing far more, how should we say, psychedelically derived music.
It changed by about 66, 67, started to get psychedelic.
until about the mid-60s, Britain was black and white. Britain was like beige, basically. You know, everything looked fairly dreary. What LSD did was, for the people who took it, they began to see the world quite literally in terms of primary colours.
And we started taking loads of LSD, which produced more space, I suppose, or, you know. And we used to play a hell of a lot on acid. You know, we'd do some acid and play on it.
Everything was big and bright and bold, the art, photography, clothes, light shows at rock venues, 3 minute songs became 30 minute songs, you know, time stretched.
And I think where the Ealing Club went was that it didn't, the musicians had moved on and the club hadn't.
Not good enough, big venue we couldn't put in because need a lot of money. So it was, we got a license for 1 year as a Broadway casino in the back room. And the front, we used to put soft music, soft musician, poker, blackjack, and roulette table. But it did not work. It just was very quiet. 66, then we realized soul music coming up. So start advertising, and we got some group, and then we had quite a lot of group come in, all African. We had all the record labels sent to us by in Jamaica, and soul and reggae, and it did pick up for 2 years until 67. It was very hot, soul and reggae, and 68 quite down again. So we went back to disco again. Disco become popular then. Then we had a discotheque, we had a proper deck we made up, and two turntable and discotheque, and we had a DJ. Most of our DJs were girls and go-go dancers. It was popular. We had about 27, 28 go-go dancers. I did my best. Lots of spotlight and lots of what we call it, a special glass you put in the front of projector to project different psychedelic lighting and all that. I did all of that, but it wasn't enough. They wanted more. Well, that's what we call it a day. 12 years is enough. Well, I don't know. That was good old days.
The Red Room is still a venue that's open on Friday and Saturday nights. You can go down there and listen to house music, and there's a place for house music in every town. I believe it's got 360,000 people living in the borough. It's one of the most diverse populations in Britain, if not the world. You've got strong populations from Poland, from Eastern Europe, from Somalia, from India, of all types, Pakistan, everywhere. You've got so many different languages that are being spoken. That is a great potential for future types of music to be generated from the area. My name is Alistair Young. I'm one of the directors of the Ealing Club Community Interest Company. We're a social enterprise that doesn't have anything to do with the actual venue today. We occasionally do events here, but basically we set up to highlight Ealing's music heritage and tried to use that to inspire new opportunities for live music. Crossrail, one of the biggest engineering projects in Western Europe, will connect East London to Central London to West London. Ealing Broadway, where we sit today, stands on that railway line just a few metres away. That is going to mean that this place disappears, that it's going to get demolished.
Well, every movement has to have its egg that it breaks out of. And with the English blues movement, it happened to be London, and it happened to be the Ealing Club. It happened to be Alexis Corner's management of that club and him recruiting people to come and be there.
I think that everybody that was a performer in London in the early 60s, 61, 2 and 3, owes a debt to Alexis, who opened up the whole of the club scene, made it possible for other bands to perform. They couldn't all go and perform at the Ealing Rhythm and Blues Club.
It was the foundation, really, of where all that British blues started.
Well, the Ealing Club is a cradle of British rock because British rock was invented by a small group of musicians who were reinterpreting Chicago blues for a European audience, and they all started playing in that club. They either played in the club or they discovered the music in that club. And of course, you know, we have the Rolling Stones, who were the main ones. They took the kind of music that Alexis Corner had discovered or had popularised, and they took it further. They made it into music for youth, you know, a kind of popular music, mass market music for kids, and that all really happened, all started at Ealing.
You're happy.
I'm happy, yeah, I'm
okay,
happy.
Okay, good boy.